Cat TV is celebrating 30 years of community media. Help support Cat TV's next 30 years by becoming a member today. Your membership will help us continue covering meaningful, local content. Thank you for supporting your local community media station.
October 11th, Southwest Vermont Union Elementary District meeting as a temporary chair. The agenda goes as follows: Pledge of Allegiance, Public Comment, Consent Agenda, and Forest Finance. And we have a Williams College donation and Bennett Elevator Design Change Order along with the Treasurer's Report. Superintendent's Report, 4 policies, the Chair's Report, Principal's Report, and for your information, Budget Status Report and the Student Enrollment Numbers for October. If the agenda is okay with everybody present.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all.
Thank you. Are there members of the public who wish to comment?
Are there any members of the public on?
I do not see any.
Seeing none, the consent agenda includes minutes, warrants. There are no leave of absences, retirements, 4 resignations, and no nominations.
Is there a motion to approve?
A motion.
Okay. Motion by Taylor, second by Cameron. Discussion?
In the minutes, could we change it from June 14th to September 13th? On the agenda?
Oh. Well, why don't we do that?
We're changing the agenda, not necessarily the minutes.
Right.
Correct. Correct.
Yes.
And number one, being closed, the minutes from June 14th, to reflect that it's the minutes from September.
Did you get all that, Richard? Okay.
Well, actually, the minutes say the meeting was September 13th.
Yes, but the...
Yeah,
agenda's minutes enclosed, June
14th. Right, so it's both wrong month and day.
September. I thought the date was okay on the minutes.
What was that, Richard?
I thought September 13th was the date. I might be wrong on that one.
No, yeah. No, your minutes are right. It's in the on the agenda.
Yeah, it's just the agenda.
Yeah.
Right.
We don't need a motion to do that.
I think it'll reflect in his
to take care of this. And we have no further discussion. So then all those in favor of approval of the consent agenda for October 6th by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed or abstentions? None. Next item of business is finance. There's a treasurer's report. Did I see that posted?
I don't.
I didn't see it.
I don't have it.
Well, maybe we'll leave that out. We have the Bennington elevator design change order number 1.
No. That's in there.
Speak to you.
I can. It's an additional cost. And it's for the geotechnical engineering part of the engineers made a determination because, you know, there's a sump to an elevator site, so they have to do excavations there. So it's been determined they've got to do some geothermal testing first, make sure that they're not going to be building on fill or any other previous site that might have been there. So you can, it's a design change, so you're voting on the additional cost of $6,738. And then if you vote that, then I can sign it.
Any discussion? Is,
and this is for the elevator at Bennington Elementary School, the design of the do the structural engineering. You need to, we need to do this geothermal engineering first. Geotechnical engineering.
That's a necessary part of the project. So.
Accepted.
We have a motion from Sue, second.
Second.
Second from Tammy. Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the Bennell elevator design change totaling $6,734, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No abstentions? Motion carries. The amount's approved. Item C is Williams College donation to Powell School in the amount of $5,000. I believe we need a motion to accept.
And there is a letter in your packet and from his principal on how they will use that $5,000 donation from Williams College.
Do we have a motion to accept that?
Mm-hmm.
Motion by Kayla. Second. Second by Sandy. Any further discussion?
Just a typo on that agenda.
Oh.
Collage.
That's what
Williams is. That's what
collage. Any more discussion?
No, just these little things, just, you know.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Or abstentions? Okay, motion carries. The letter was included. Superintendent's report.
First, Director of Finance, Renee Gordon, sent you an email earlier. I don't know if you've seen it. There is an additional warrant that needs to be signed, so I can pass that around. It was late for the agenda, so she had that for you. A couple of housekeeping, and with three members absent, I don't know if you want to defer to another meeting, but we do need representatives from this school board the for negotiations. Scott McNary is listed as, I think I have Chris Murphy coming into the meeting.
Yeah, he says he didn't get the, he never got the agenda, so he didn't know, like, he
didn't. Scott McNary is listed as the negotiating rep from this board with the teachers. We have no one listed to be the negotiating rep with the educational support personnel, and that is going to start this year. The teachers will start next year. And we also will need someone to be the representative from this board to negotiate with administrators, because that will begin this year too. So we're looking for two representatives from this board for negotiations, one for educational support personnel. And now that we have Chris here, I don't know if that's something, I don't need it tonight, so if that's something that you want to survey your board to see who would like to be the representative from educational support personnel and one for the administrators, which is principals and vice principals, not directors. So those two units are up this year, but sooner rather than later. Chris, I think you're muted, Chris.
So folks, my apologies about that. I've not yet turned over my email address, so I never received an agenda, and so it wasn't on my radar. It should have been on my radar, but it just wasn't. So my apologies to everyone there and for being late.
We had a quorum, Chris, so it was fine. We were able to start, and the board made Dick the acting chair, which our legal counsel advised us we could do, because we need the chair, vice chair, or clerk here. So, but now you're here.
Yeah, and so I'm pulling up the agenda now so I can...
I know the administrative unit is pretty anxious to begin negotiating. So if you could appoint someone to be that representative soon, just email both me and Nick Golf, the director of HR, who's going to be representing you on that. That'll be fine. And then who will be educational support personnel?
Okay.
I wanted to give you an update on inter-school choice. It's been a few years now that we've had, we call it school choice, but the name on the form is intra-school choice. And this is something that happened when we merged the district. So we do have an application process, and we have a procedure spelled out for, how that is carried out. As give you an idea of where we are number-wise, we have had 47 applications for inter-school choice, and there are 37 non-resident students in an inter-school choice school. So the non-resident is the term we would use. I'll give you an example. If you are from Pownell, but you're attending school in Bennington, you're attending as a non-resident student because you're not a resident of that town. And when we merged the districts, that allowed that to be possible. So there are 37 students currently in a school that they are not a resident of that attendance zone or that town. Met recently with principals to get feedback on how they feel that program is working and, should there be any adjustments to it, which then I will bring back to the board because this was your vote to develop inter-school choice. So I will be bringing back to you some possible changes as we do this. When we started, we used the Mount Anthony Union High School school choice application as a model so that parents would be familiar with, trying to use the same documents as much as possible. The high school school choice is a state program that shares seats between other high schools. So that's always been there, but it had a March 1st deadline. So when I developed inter-school choice for us, I used that same deadline so that parents would at least might be on their radar. Principals are asking that we consider doing a further back deadline, more like June 1st, to give them a better idea of what class sizes might be in their schools. I still need to process that and see how I think that may play out, but I don't really think that that would be a problem other than we'll have to get Katie West really involved in, changing the website and publicizing that out to families. So, that, you can apply anytime you want, but the deadline would be June 1st, which I think gives us plenty of time for my office to then turn around, see where there are openings at different grade levels and whether we can offer that inter-school choice seat to a family. For those who might not have been here or need a refresher, this is by May 1st of every year, so you have to apply by March 1st, but then by May 1st, I would make a determination of the number of spaces in each of the elementary schools available to choice students. Resident students would be given a priority placement in any classes or programs within their home school. With respect to non-resident students, so in other words, if you live in the Bennington attendance zone for Bennington Elementary, you are the priority to go there. Then we would add, so let's use an example. We use the number 20 as the guideline for class size because that's the Vermont quality standards is 20. It's not some people think that that's a number that's negotiated in the teacher's contract. It's not. It's a Vermont quality standard. So some classes, sometimes there'll be more than 20. There might be less than 20, but we use 20. So if there was less than 20 students in that classroom, then I would declare by May 1st that, like, say there was only 16 kids in there. I said that there's 4 seats available for intra-school choice. And then we'd go down the list and offer those to families. And we would send a letter to both principals, both the school choice principal and the resident school principal. They would each get a letter, the sending and the receiving school. Principals ask, we also make sure that we extend to student support services because the services change with that, follow with that student. So that was a very good suggestion that we would then put them on the CC list for that. The selection of non-resident students for admission is in the form of a random drawing when the number of requests exceed the number of available spaces, and that has happened. let's say I would have two openings and four applications for a kindergarten seat at Monument. We're doing a random drawing of who gets those two seats, and then the others can wait listed.
If a family has two children and the older child is attending their school of choice, what happens to the younger sibling?
I want to be clear on that before I answer you.
I thought we addressed that.
Yeah. I did too.
So in the definitions, it doesn't list that there is a priority given to someone who already has a student in that school.
So say there's six kids that want to go to a specific school. Yes. There's four openings. You said it's a random drawing of those six kids?
Yes.
And if you change it to, so before it was March 1st deadline, you told them by May 1st the amount of seats available.
Right.
If it's going to be June 1st, what is the new deadline of letting the families know?
So what I'm leaning to, the principals are talking to you, what I'm thinking is doing a May 1st application deadline, and I'll come back to you with a final proposal, but I wanted to talk not so with a June 15th or last day of school, whichever is sooner, that we notify parents so that they would know by and that, you know, that gives my office over a month to process the applications and then coincide with where the openings are in the different schools.
So I have a question from the principal's perspective. Why, I would think you would want to know earlier than later. So what is the benefit of knowing later for them? I'm just curious.
I think they want more time to see who's coming into their district and taking those seats from within in their resident district. And so that then they're not overpopulating those grade levels. So like if they basically hold those seats open for as long as possible, see who's moving into their district, and then that the seats are available. Because the second part of this, what we've been doing is we do a second round. We have been doing a second round in August, and that's something that the principals are asking that we consider discontinuing. I'm not saying that that is what I will recommend or whether that would be a good idea. What we would do, we would look in first week of August, anybody who's on our waiting list who didn't get in the first round, are there still seats available? Because from June until August, there's always some in and out, right? Mm-hmm. So maybe another seat opens up and we can really give a family a choice that they want. Principals were pretty strongly against that because they, you know, feel rosters are already set, but they're not always set, because as any principal can tell you, you're going to have people even show up, you know, the 2 days before the start of school or the start of school or here I am. So so the principal is concerned, if I fill up those open seats in August, what happens to the walk-in student at the end? And now you're 20, but remember that 10, 20 is a guideline. It's not, and we are public schools. We can't say you can't come.
So I have a follow-up on my other question. So if they want more time to see who their residents are, isn't it more of your deadline than, so what if you kept the March 1st deadline? That's requiring families, they need to let the school or central office know by March 1st that yep. they'd like a accommodation. But then extend the time frame that you guys are going to say this is the amount of time open. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Because that seems to be more of their concerns, the principal's concerns, than the time that they're being notified that there's people interested in inter-school choice. You know what I mean? I would think the earlier we would know that, the better.
But the one question I would have on that is the week after school ends, that's the time when teachers get together to start looking at the data for the following school year. So they may want to know who was in their class. The teachers may need to know so they can look at that information.
Right. No, I agree with the second deadline.
So like, say we extended instead of it May 1st, we did June 1st or June 15th, whatever your recommendation is, the last day of school, on announcing to those who have applied that these are the openings.
Right.
But why does it, why would it affect principals to know earlier students that want to come into their schools? I mean, that's what I'm missing.
Yeah, I mean, with those kind of numbers, I think school inter-school choice has been a success.
Mm-hmm.
Has it been widely embraced by all of our schools? I think people are comfortable with the families they know from their own school district. And when, so, and I'm talking in general terms, and I really shouldn't do that, but I feel that it's not been as, because particularly when we get to that August deadline, that's what, if I took one thing away from my meeting with principals, is eliminate the second round. You know, how many you put into our class? And the other thing that they asked, and I don't think I can agree with this, is that I leave under the 20 gap. Like say, I'm only gonna go to 18 when I do school, inter-school choice, and leave two seats open in case somebody moves in. But you could be at 20 with your own school district, and if somebody moves in, you still have to take that student. That's the nature of a public school. And some years you're going to be under that number, and some years you're going to be, you know, you're going to be over that number. And but again, I'm bringing it to you for feedback, so that as I rewrite these procedures, and then I'll present this to you at a future meeting, and then we'll have, once we, whatever changes we make, then we'll promote with Katie West to get that information out to parents. So
my other question, I guess, would be, if there is an exodus from a particular school, whichever one it is, you want to know the why?
We don't ask that on the application. And honestly, like when I look at the notes that are on here, a lot of it has to do like with where the parents work. Mm-hmm. You know, where their daycare is. One thing I understand too is it's a permanent thing. Once you're a school choice student, like you apply for at the second grade level, you stay there until you reach the terminal grade for that school, which is fifth grade in Bennington and sixth grade in others. So you are part of that community. It's not, you don't have to apply for inter-school choice every year. You're there. So it's not, I don't see that it's, I have students from, you know, Monument that want to have school choice to Bennington Elementary School. I have students from Woodford that have school choice to Molly Stark and going the other way. So I really surprisingly do not see a pattern here that, you know, you might jump to a conclusion that there's nexus from one school, and it's, so I don't see, you know, I would like to hear that, because there was two sides of this argument, and I think Sandy, you mentioned it. So you go into, we'll go to a school, you go to Woodford as a kindergarten student, even though you live in Bennington, your school choice. Now you're in the third grade and your sibling comes along. Do they get a, you know, and this is a philosophical discussion. Somebody say, no, everyone has a chance for that other kindergarten class. You give a preference to somebody who's already there than who you're excluding. And sure, you say, well, a parent doesn't want their kid at two different schools. Again, that's a parental choice. So I can see it, you know, I've had both sides of the argument, but I would welcome how the board feels about that as we make, you know, do we give a preference to a sibling of someone who's already in that school?
Isn't that in a policy? Because I kind of remember debating it at one of the meetings, and maybe it was prior to us as one.
Yeah, it's not in here.
Because I can see both sides of the argument too. I can see the reason why you want, but then I can understand, like, well, you're taking that risk as a parent.
It does say that. It does say that. Preference we give to siblings of admitted students if an opening exists in the grade. If there are more eligible siblings than open slots, a lottery for the siblings will be held. So that's the protection. So it's not. Yeah, it's not an automatic acceptance. It's got to be an opening. And if there are more eligible siblings than open slots, a lottery can be held. So that's. So I'm looking at my notes from principals and the procedure. The notes from principal was, you know, mixed reactions on whether we wanted to continue with that or not. And the other thing about this, and there was question again about equity on this, as we continue with inter-school choice, there is no transportation. Parents have to acknowledge that there's no transportation because we can't be sending buses from Pownall to Shaftesbury and vice versa. Just logistics of it and the cost of it would be prohibitive. So it does limit, you know, some people's options for that. That was a question that was raised on whether that, you know, what's the equity of that. But I don't see what, short of eliminating inter-school choice, I don't see how you can take that away.
Yeah, I mean, there's a school that has the same curriculum within the district, so that they have the option to go to with transportation.
And from your examples, it appears that people are leaving because of the transportation. Well, because of a work environment or because of a daycare aftercare situation, and not necessarily because they feel as though one school is superior to another. If I understand your letters, if I understand your letters as you're sharing them with us correctly, that's how I understood it.
And I have one other question. So say a school like, okay, so you have somebody from Monument that has inter-school choice and goes to Shaftesbury.
Yep.
And you're saying that once they get selected, they have the ability to stay there through sixth grade.
Yep.
What if they choose after fifth grade to go to the middle school? Do they have to stay there until sixth grade? Or do they have the option to then go to the middle school for sixth grade?
A Bennington resident would have the option to go to the middle school at sixth grade because they can stay because, and that could apply to anyone. Just because you went to Shaftesbury at school choice as a first grader or a kindergarten student doesn't mean at third grade you could opt to go back to Pownall.
Okay, your residency. You can always go back to your residency.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what happens to the outlying schools when they hit that sixth grade? Because it's a great question. Do they have the option of going to the middle school?
Currently, you don't. Yeah.
What about their school choice? Like, is that one of the...
Well, this is Union Elementary School's district's inter-school choice policy, which has no bearing on MAU. You would have to negotiate some type of inter-agreement with MAU, which is possible. And then the money transfer is really just who then counts that student in their school count, but that's a whole other.
So if I live in Pownall, which I do, and is this gonna work out right?
I think
yes, and I have school choice and I want my child to go to Bennell or one of the Bennington elementary schools.
Yep.
And then when the child gets to fifth grade, there isn't a sixth grade.
Correct.
They have to go then back to Pownall.
Then what happens?
Because that's a tricky one.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to put that on my list. I don't know if we've gotten there with that yet. Yeah. Because then usually then I get...
my friend is that like to the middle school.
Yeah.
I think that might have already worked out,
Sandy, but I don't have that answer for you tonight. I think that, yeah, I don't want to answer it. So let me.
I have to imagine it's happened over the last 3 years. And I have to imagine that they were able to go to the middle school.
Yeah. I want to say, yes, that's probably what's happening, but I want to.
Because I think we would have heard already complaints if
it's sticky though.
It is very sticky because then the argument could be like, why can't a Shaftesbury student try to request school choice to go, because technically, because then you're kind of asking, oh, I want school choice of Molly Stark, but there is no sixth grade Molly Stark, so that really pushes me to the middle school.
Or it makes you think as a family member, perhaps.
We may not have had this happen.
Or perhaps I would say in fifth grade, I will request choice in fifth grade, and then I know, I mean, if that was
something
I felt strongly about.
If you're a little bit more sophisticated and wanting, is that a dodge, wait, an end around,
End around it, or, and you're just.
Well, this is why, you know, the more people I ask this question to, the more questions I get, so that's good. That did not come up with the principals, man.
Because I actually had that whole middle school discussion with somebody not so long ago. They asked me that question and I couldn't answer it. Like if somebody had to go back to the, no, not go back to the
middle school. I've heard of anybody going back.
No, not so go back to the middle school. But
either
like
they've transitioned to the middle school and they just are ending up in MAU student count, or it hasn't happened yet because we haven't had enough years of somebody coming from a non-Bennington school to Bennington. Right. Any other input you would like to give me on inter-school choice as I redraft this?
I kind of like the June 1st timeline because it gives families the opportunity to really think about what they might be doing.
Yeah.
I feel like the later we tell them, the harder it is for them to potentially set up an option if they don't get it.
Right. And especially if transportation, this is like the principals want, some principals suggested that we wait completely to August and see how many seats are there. But to me, it's top line families, especially with transportation, they have to arrange that transportation.
And on this question, not that you've even asked this question of transportation though, is there a point where we may ask families to request transportation just in general so that we know how many seats that we're actually using on a bus? And I only ask that because sometimes you see just a few seats taken on a bus because a lot of parents will come do one or the other. So is there a point where we could just be, you know, say, are you planning on using the bus in the fall?
I don't know if I want to open that door, you know, because I logistically, I don't see how we could ever do it. When I look, you know,
bus routes,
where they're crossing from. Sure. Within Bennington, we could probably make it work because there's enough buses crossing streets and routes that we could tell a student who, say, wasn't Monument but wants to go to Bennington Elementary School, but they can't get there. And I know that's probably too close of a scenario. But we could tell them, well, if you walk three blocks, you can get on a bus because that bus goes that way.
I was
but
thinking
it wouldn't
that.
Work for.
I was just thinking, just in general, because I remember a time when Pownell had three buses and then went to two because they just didn't need three.
Yeah.
But for a lot of years, they did have the three. So my question is, can we plan that in advance so that whoever's designing the bus routes?
But I think to Jim's point, like with the elementary schools, like the bus routes don't cross each other. Like so, the bus routes that support Molly Stark, they don't cross each other. Like you would never be near a Woodford stop. So like if you were to do that, you would have these buses traveling all the way far out of their districts to, I think that's where the complexity comes from. So like they're, all those kids are kind of in a cluster.
And we're not gonna, we could never like I quickly look at like this for from Pownell that are going to other districts. We could never afford to run a bus for poor students.
I don't
understand what you're asking.
A lot of times I will look on a bus and I will not see students on it, but we're running it.
Yeah.
And so my question is there ever a point when we can just ask families, do you intend on using the bus?
Union in general.
Nothing at all to do with.
All right, well, that's where my confusion is because we're in the school choice. I thought you were advocating that I run buses for school choice.
No, sorry.
I'm sure in Woodford, if there's no elementary, no high school on the top of the mountain, they're not running to the top.
Well, they're not, but I'm just thinking of the example of when Pownell had run three buses and then went to two because it just wasn't.
Isn't that looked at each year, like when we're?
Yeah, we have software that looks at where.
But we don't necessarily ask the families. That's the question. So like right now, there's a bus that I can go on, but my kids don't take it because, and especially nowadays, it may be a good idea. To Sandy's point, it may be a good idea to could, like, because I think we asked it during COVID, so maybe
we did during COVID.
So maybe we do it again each year, only because, like, you have a lot more parents working from home than they did in the past. And so you have a lot more parents driving their kids than they did in the past. So, like, I'm one of them. Like, I work from home now, so there's no reason for my kids to take the bus. So I think that it, to Sandy's point, in general, not talking about inter-school choice, but it may be something that we may want to survey to what right before potentially the bus situation is set for each year. And but the bottom line is, and I think this is what you're probably going to come back and say, it's people probably don't answer these surveys.
Not to the return rate that you would think that would, get us to the point that we would eliminate a bus.
But if it depended on whether you're going to have a bus in the fall, you might consider it.
Yeah.
And now the bus goes by your house. I'm just using you as an example. Yeah. The bus goes by your house, but it may not have to, is my point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I get your point.
So I have one more, getting back to school choice.
Sorry.
I have one more. I don't have clear input from this board how you feel about the second date, the practice that we've been doing of looking at August and seeing if there's open seats and do we continue to open those. Principals are asking that we don't do that second date.
My personal opinion is if there's seats open.
And that was my...
I agree, because what difference would it make if I moved into the neighborhood the last week of August, or if I had to find out middle of August?
And how you do your lottery if you don't have that second date?
Right. And then what's the point of a waiting list if you don't have the second date?
Right. Well, they would say there would be no waiting list.
Right.
If you didn't get in June, you can apply again next year, but there is no room in the inn this year. So
sounds harsh.
Well, I think the reason we designed this, right, We wanted to give people choice, and I don't like to get hung up on deadlines, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why would I say no to a seat that's there that somebody wants that would make somebody happy or help their childcare situation or help their work commute situation? Why would we say no to that, right? Just because of the deadline. We waived the deadlines the past 2 years because of COVID, so we've been, but we're going to go back on that. So it sounds like what I'm hearing from the board, continue with, look at the late deadline.
Right. I mean, it was one of the biggest benefits of us consolidating as a district to begin with.
Good. Well, then I welcome your input, and as I continue to draft this, and I'll bring it back in a new application, a new procedure with whatever these changes are, and they're going to be minor. One other thing the principals, and this is a little tough, they'd asked to add a line to the application that warns that if transportation becomes an issue, you may be returned to a resident school. What that means is if, you're responsible for your own transportation, and now your child is not showing up every day, and transportation, so now you're truant a lot because you can't get to school. They're asking, the principals asked that I would consider putting that you are going to go back to where you can get to school. You can either walk or take a bus.
I think that's reasonable.
I kind of think it's reasonable too. I think we want to be careful of how we word it.
Right.
Yeah.
And how we interpret and place it too, that doesn't seem, arbitrary or discriminatory that we're saying that, like,
well, if they're truancy,
right.
Maybe you make that, because that's like a state thing where police are involved.
Yeah.
I mean, like, that's a whole other,
I don't want to get spoken, I'm defining how many absences kicks that.
But the policy does.
Right.
Yeah.
So, like, the truancy policy does. So, if there's risk of truancy, then I think that maybe that's how we word it, because we wouldn't want a child potentially having that risk.
I will consult with legal counsel on what the wording should say for adding a line like that to the application that says you risk your placement if attendance becomes an issue.
I think Chris might have a thought on this. I could see his brain.
So we need to find a clear way to document the reason for truancy. I mean, if we're relying strictly on parental report, I don't know that that's a, I don't know that we can rely on that as the indicator that's as true. To why a child has been truant. So I agree with the, idea that, you know, if a kid is not showing up to school, maybe we could even say chances are it's because of a lack of transportation, but I don't know that we can, I don't know that yet we know a way to definitively say that truancy is based on a lack of transportation. And therefore I would not necessarily want to disrupt a kid's educational placement strictly because of our guess as to why truancy is occurring.
Good point.
Because I agree, Chris, that like, I don't want to move that student. Once they make that decision that they stay there, what can we do to help them get to school on time every day, as opposed to moving them mid-year or at the end of the year?
Sure. Because, I mean, as we see right now, the vast majority of our students who are truant are in, are resident students, right? So where transportation is not an issue.
Right.
And have we seen that? Like, is this coming out of a place that request for that language? Is this coming out of a place from experience? Or is that just an assumption because of the transportation issue?
In just tonight's agenda. Student enrollment numbers. Yeah. They were in your packet, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
The last two pages, I got them here.
I don't have it on my page, but it does show that it's an attachment, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What is it showing for?
Percentages, 90s, low 90s.
No, but I mean, like, are the principals saying that they're noticing truancy, not truancy, but attendance issues with those particular students that are already, you know what I mean? Like, what's
no,
making
I don't
them
think
come up with that?
I don't think that's what I said. I just have in mind that that was a request that they had, but not, I don't know if this
is
specific to
it. I think it is a reasonable request, but I say we hold off on that kind of wording. My opinion would be we hold off on that kind of wording until maybe we have more time in this and maybe we do some data analysis to see if it's actually an issue. You know, like, are we seeing transportation issues with these kids that are school choice? That is causing a reason to have that language. Yeah. If we're not, then we're making an issue that we're kind of potentially.
And I don't have any data that shows that there are school choice attending children who are truant.
Right. So I would say that it's not an issue at this point, and until it is an issue, then we address it then.
So the other question I have is, how many kids or how many families maybe change jobs and then want to change back to the schools? Has that happened? Like a football?
Lose your job
or something, you know, where they hope to be back in their home school instead of and how do they yeah. How does that process
work? I don't have that in front of me. That information is anybody who's been school choice and been gone back to their resident school. I imagine that, I mean, it certainly has happened. We have students that move for other reasons, placement issues, but you know, whether it's a state place student or something like that may move, but it wouldn't be a problem. They can go back to their resident school. That's where they go. So, okay. But we also, we would not force them to go back. They don't have to reapply every year. It stays until they reach the terminal grade for that school. But, you know, if for whatever reason they want to go back to their home school, then they're entitled to go there. Yeah. All right, well, thank you for your input for that as we guide. And I think I appreciate the input that the principals gave us on this as we, you know, take a look at this and see how it's doing. I was actually surprised by the number of students when I asked for the report of who's, you know, in a non-resident district. So thank you. And that's my report this evening.
We turn this over to Chris.
getting that fit. Okay, thank you. And thanks, Dick, for pinch hitting while I myself was tardy. So that brings us down to agenda item 6, which is our policy section. We have 4 to warn. 1019, which is the non-discriminatory mascots and school branding. Draft policy 5300, which has to do with grievance protocol for 504 and ADA compliance. We have 5510, which is our equity policy, which is a point of essentially principles and points of practice. And then draft policy 5520, which is transgender and gender non-conforming students. I would just note that the first two, 1019 and 5300, those, if not entirely, at least include processes for grieving and making complaints, which I think are important for us to review. And then, of course, the other two as well. So I would accept a motion to warn all 4 policies as published, please.
Second.
Thanks. We have a first and a second. Any discussion on approving, on warning the policies as published?
One thing, and I'm trying to figure out which line it is, but in one part of it, it has that the superintendent will adapt procedures, and I don't know if that's in place.
Yeah.
I apologize. I only have line 27, so I'm thumbing through these to see which line 27 says the superintendent will adapt policies.
It isn't necessarily been practice that follows the procedures.
Right.
So are you referring to 5520? It looks like page 2, line 27.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay. So now that we're taking a look at that, Sandy, could you please just repeat your question, Sandy?
I was just wondering if the superintendent started to adopt any procedures.
5520.
Jim, if you, maybe you can give just an outline about how, generally speaking, how does the supervisory union, how do the individual districts make sure that their admin regs match FERPA requirements? Maybe
I think that's a different question. Because I think it's because I always thought the procedures went beyond and they weren't actually part of the policy. But in this instance, we're asking it to be part of the policy, and that's why I asked about it. Typically, the superintendent's procedures or the administrative procedures will come later.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't say that they can't. It just says that it directs the superintendent to adopt them.
Yeah.
It will adopt.
So we'll draft them.
After you draft the policy.
Right. Yeah, because I think the creation and adoption of admin regs almost always follows. We need to approve a policy before we can start to develop the admin regs. But I think that's been typically been our practice.
Okay.
And there is a section on the sheet that follows the policy development that lists whether or not procedures have been developed.
All right. Any other questions or discussion about the motion to warn? All right, so hearing none, all those in favor of warning the 4 policies as published, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Any abstentions? All right, the motion passes. Okay, so agenda item 7 is the chair's report, and I will say that there is no chair report this evening, which will then move us into agenda item 8, which is a principal report.
The superintendent apologizes with the holiday yesterday. I did not designate a principal to come to the meeting. That totally slipped my mind. So, a practice of having one principal a month come to you and give a report on their school. I will take the blame for that there isn't a principal tonight because I did not ask any of them.
Okay. All right.
I'll make sure that brings have us one for you for next.
Thank you. So that's agenda item 9 then. Just the FYI, the information that was posted and to be posted, which includes the budget status report and student enrollment numbers. I would say that if anyone is interested in serving as a bargaining rep in the 2 contracts that the superintendent mentioned when I joined the meeting, you can please let me know that. So you can give me a call, send me an email, throw me a text, whichever you'd prefer. But I'd like to get those people identified sooner rather than later, so that we can have a seat at that table. And with that, I guess I would also just encourage everyone, if you haven't already, to make sure you switch over your email addresses to the SVSU server. You might miss some important information if you don't do that. So with that, I will entertain a motion to adjourn. Thank you very much. We have a first and a second. Any discussion on adjourning? Okay, hearing none, all those in favor of adjourning, please signify by saying aye. Aye. Any opposed? Any abstentions? The motion carries. All right, thank you very much, everyone.
CAT TV is celebrating 30 years of community media. Help support CAT TV's next 30 years by becoming a member today. Your membership will help us continue covering meaningful, local content. Thank you for supporting your local community media station.